Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome, welcome, welcome. Well, how have you been? Been off for a week, so now we're back with our classes here at our Columbia County Library and everything. Did you have a good week? I missed you, my virtual audience. Well, today's class is we're going to be doing photography of basics, okay? So this is kind of a connection with some of our other classes that we have coming up this week and also next week as well. We're getting close to the end of September. Have you felt the weather getting a little bit cooler? Yay, okay? So very glad that you're here with me today. Let me introduce myself. My name is Alex Cooper. I teach the computer classes at the Columbia County Libraries. I teach at the Columbia County Library in Evans, the Harlem Library, Uchi Creek, now the Grovetown Library. Yay, we have a new library in Grovetown. And those libraries have openings, but I'll talk about that in just a second. I'll talk about that in just a second. A big one here, of course, is that we're doing stuff virtually. So make sure that you post your questions into the chat. The chat is a little bit of a delay, so it may take a second or two for me to actually answer your questions. So just realize that. So the big thing I always start off with is, how can I help? Okay. How can I help? What questions do you have? What can I help, answer? This is a fun class today, you know, a little bit less technical than our like Scratch classes. And of course, Word and Excel and stuff. So let's talk about some of the classes we have going on for the rest of the month. All right, so today we're doing our basic photography basics in the morning. We're actually going to be doing a gadget help with me, Alex. Gadget help, virtual live gadget help on the 23rd. And then on the afternoon, we're going to be doing our second class here, which is our photography fundamentals and cloud backup. I kind of view these photography classes as kind of like a series of classes. So if you come to each one, you'll probably learn a little bit something new. And on Thursday, we're actually going to be doing, in the morning, we're going to be doing our Chess 101 class for our Grovetown Library. Of course, it's all here on our YouTube channel. And then in the afternoon, we're going to be doing advanced photo editing, that's a class we've had before, but we're actually adding layers to that. So Thursday, we're going to be doing a new class about editing and editing layers using our GIMP software. So come join me for that. And then next week, and we'll have Thursday's classes up at the end of, probably the end of this week, or at least the beginning of next week. Tuesday, we're going to be doing the photography printing and virtual scrapbooking. So if you've been in the advanced photo editing class before, we did virtual scrapbooking at the end, but now that's been promoted to its own class, okay? And then on the 30th, we're going to be doing cord cutting basics on the 30th in the morning, and then in the afternoon, we're going to be doing creating videos and editing basics. So come join me for that. Of course, all these videos are up and available later here on our YouTube channel. Don't forget, our libraries are open with limited services and hours. Curbside holds pickup is available, and you can go to gchrl.org for details or call the library with questions Monday through Friday, 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. No in-house classes. Of course, we're doing all our stuff virtually, and no study rooms and some other things like that. So check out our website for more information. Don't forget to like us on Facebook and subscribe to our YouTube channel. One of the things we're trying to do is to get our own YouTube address. We need 100 subscribers to get that. And if you are searching for our YouTube channel, the easiest way to find it is just to search YouTube for GCHRL videos, and it'll pull right up. So let's go back and let's talk about what we're going to cover this afternoon. Hello, hello. So we're doing a photography class. So go ahead and I will load up our handout. So as you come to classroom, just kind of say hello. And don't forget to share our videos as well. My videos or other folks that are posting stuff at the library too. Okay, so let me see. So we actually have two things. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to go through our handout. Let me post that. First is our handout. And then, we have our presentation I'm going to cover. Sorry, it took me a little longer than expected. But there we go, right there. So let's go ahead and let's pull up our handout. And of course, like I said, that is listed into the chat. I know you may be using it on a different device than just a computer screen. And if you're going to follow along with anything I do, kind of like with Word or anything, I just kind of say, have me, let me say, have me on a smaller device. And then you can follow along on the computer. Okay, so give me one second. I know it's silly, isn't it? Okay, hang on, hang on. That's funny. Okay. All right, it's loading. There we go. Okay. So it does help. There we go. All right. So it does help to have something in the right folder, doesn't it? Okay. So let's go ahead and drag stuff over here. There we go. All right. Sorry about that. Okay. Now we're good to go. Okay. So let's go ahead. And the first thing we're going to do is we're going to cover. And shoot. No, not what I want yet. Okay, so basically I'm going to cover the handout first. If I can get it to work out for me, and I'm not sure why that's. Anyway, we'll have to work with that. Okay, so let's see if I can get it to zoom in. Maybe I can get that to stop that. Okay. Well, the toolbar here is supposed to disappear, so I can actually zoom in a little bit too. I guess I'll just go up here and do zoom that way. Page width, that's what I want. Okay. So I actually try to make this as big as I can. All right, so I guess we will have that toolbar there. We'll work around it for now. Okay, so basically this is a digital camera class to try to kind of get you ready to take photos and everything and to kind of view photos and try to answer questions. Also, we'll be talking about setting it up, actually using the rule of thirds, and then we'll finish off with a really great video at the very, very end, okay? So let's talk about why do we want to use a digital camera? Well, a big one, of course, is digital versus film, viewing our pictures instantly, and being able to delete the pictures we don't want and only printing the pictures that we want, okay? The big one here is people still talk about what is a megapixel. Now, a lot of the companies now, they don't really focus on that as much with our cell phones. Mostly companies like Apple and the rest of them are trying to really focus on what exactly is their software can do, adding an extra camera, excuse me, adding an extra little lens on the newer cell phones, but we still really need to know the information here because if we were going to purchase a camera like a digital SLR or something, which we're going to talk about in just a second, we do need to know a little bit about what does a megapixel mean or some of the other terms on here. Okay, so let's start and go ahead and let's talk about the amount of detail that the camera captures is the resolution. Okay, the sensor on, let's say, a more expensive camera, which we're going to talk about that in a second. The sensor on a more expensive camera can actually be bigger, and that could be a reason why maybe it has better clarity with the picture. So when we look at our settings and everything, a lot of the time we may not actually get told that. Told what the, excuse me. May not actually get told what the sensor is or how big it is on like the box, but do realize that that can actually help us determine the resolution, but they don't actually give out that information. So just kind of realize that when you get a digital SLR, the sensor is actually larger than it can be like on a smaller camera. So let's talk about what a megapixel is, okay? So if we go here and we look at our resolution, okay. An older camera might have something like 6 megapixels. We're mostly dealing with cameras that are kind of like 16 and above is what you'll see on there. When we look at our resolutions, we actually have this. Now, when we talk about our little pixels, what exactly is a pixel? Well, a pixel basically is if you have a picture and you blow it up, then you'll actually start seeing the little squares on here, okay? So, how exactly do we make sure the squares are smaller? I guess that would be an interesting way of doing that. Well, you need to make sure that your resolution is smaller so that you can crop or blow up a picture if you want to. Okay. So, if we look at our resolution, here's our pixel by pixel. So, let's say it's a 16 megabyte camera, it does 4,000 by 3,000 pixel resolution. If you're going to talk about printing it, that's as big as you could get it without having to make it see the little pixels on there or anything. So what happens is it's not something that they want to put on a box. It's really something that they want it to be something quick, easy to sell, easy to understand. So they actually do a little bit of a math problem here. Okay. Math problem comes up. They times it by itself. They get a million, and then basically that tells you what your resolution is. Okay, excuse me, what your megapixel is. It's just an easy way to put a number on a box, but it's something that I get asked a lot of questions about. Okay, so that's kind of what a megapixel is. The higher the resolution, the more megapixel is, the higher quality it will be. Now, here's an interesting one because it talks about 35 millimeter film. If it's scanned, that's really its maximum resolution. So as you see in the future or with really, really high-end cameras, it'll actually outmax the 35 millimeters. So when you think about printing something, you may want to look at this chart, see what the resolution count is, and then see how large you could get something. But if you are using something just as simple as like a kiosk, or if you're using at Walmart, CVS, Target, any of those places, just realize that try not to crop too much because you should start to see the little megapixels if you print it out and look kind of squarey. Okay. So let's go ahead and let's talk about our different kinds of cameras. And I'll disappear so I'm not blocking it. So our first one is kind of a small point and shoot camera. Big thing about that is it's kind of small. It's easy to fit in like a pocket or something. But its lens is kind of small as well compared to some of our other cameras that we're going to talk about. They kind of consider that what's known as a point and shoot. Okay. Viewfinder provides a rough idea of what you're viewing. Okay. A lot of these now are kind of just going to like a big screen. One of the things is our cell phones are actually getting smarter and smarter. And even Apple talking about a new iPhone, talking about the lens, the quality, and of course that actually having more than one little lens on there. But do realize, why would you still want one of these or even one of the mid-range we're talking about? Because these have actual zoom in, which we'll talk about that in just a second. When we talk about our zoom, I'll show you a little example of zooming in on something. So basically we have our point and shoot, small, but wait, one of the big things about our camera is not only does it have, you know, a kind of a powerful CPU or operating system behind there, that we can actually install new software on there. So this is one of the things that even the digital SLRs or even this mid-range one or the smaller point and shoots don't have the capability of, is downloading new software or new apps to be able to do different things with your phone. One that I really like is kind of like the night capture one, this one here. It makes it really, really easy to take pictures at night, but they can keep adding features. You know, companies like Apple or Google can put out new software to make the phones work a little bit better to compensate maybe for its little limitations, okay? So these cameras are small. You might be able to get a picture of something. But maybe not very far away. So not the best if you're going to go on a trip and you want to start zooming in on something to take a picture. So basically we have kind of our mid-range point and shoot. How do you know if it's a mid-range point and shoot? Does the lens come off? Does it look like this and does the lens come off? He said, no, the lens does not come off. Okay, well that means it's a mid-range, okay? It means it's just basically a point and shoot camera with the bigger lens on it, and it may be heftier in a lot of ways and may have a bigger sensor inside. One of the things is this still has some of the shutter lag that we'll talk about in just a second. Same shutter lag as if the smaller camera means you pressing the button to take a picture and you have to wait till it takes the picture. So what is a digital SLR? Well, it's a big thing to kind of discuss. So let's discuss it. You see the actual image that will exposed into the digital sensor. How does that work? Well, when you look through the peephole here, instead of being here and here and even here, looking through the screen of what the camera thinks it'll actually capture, you're actually looking through mirrors here that bounce back and forth, and you actually are looking through exactly what the lens will capture. Now it will blink and it usually will make a noise, maybe not a very loud noise, but it'll usually make a noise. If you're, you know, take a picture, it kind of blinks its eye so it can take the picture, and at that time you won't actually be able to see. I've heard a more sports focused photographer, and he talk about photography, and one of the things he said was that when the ball the person's about to catch the ball, if he saw the ball get caught through the eye hole, the peephole, viewfinder, that means that he did not get the shot or the picture. But if he didn't see the person actually catch the ball, that means he probably got the shot of them catching the ball. So that was a positive thing. Big thing about these are the lenses can come off. And there are some ways that you can actually use lenses from an older camera. So if you do have something in the attic, it is possible to get a new digital SLR and it might fit. It is possible. It depends on the brand and all that. So we actually have these cameras provide more control and better imaging. They have a bigger sensor on the inside. I know that there's some that are kind of like hybrids. They're trying to be small, but also have removable lens on there. Just kind of remember, there's if they have a removable lens, they're probably a digital SLR with the mirror in there. So it doesn't really matter, even if they're kind of smaller. Sony's doing some smaller ones that look more like a point and shoot, but they're still, you know, have a big lens on there. All right, so let's keep going here. Let's talk about our zoom, okay? And I'm actually going to switch over to our PowerPoint for a second. So we talked about our example with pixels. So here's our deer, okay, deer. We have our deer here, and if we zoomed in more and more and more, then we'd actually start seeing the pixels of the ear. Okay, so that's why you do want something that has a higher resolution to it. Now let's talk about our digital zoom and our optical zoom. Okay, here's our original picture. If we actually had a real optical zoom 10 times with our compact camera, we usually maybe get 3x on there. And if we zoom in, we start to get something like a 10x. If you have a higher, and also a camera that I have actually has like 35 or something on their optical zoom, meaning that lens zooms out and moves in and out. Now, what's the difference between optical and digital? So if we look here at our optical, we can see that the resolution is still very high. So it's taking a picture, but it's just zoomed in. The digital zoom, it's not real zoom. It's like cropping a picture. It'll be blurry, and you'll actually start to see the little pixels, okay? So that's not really what you want. You actually do want to use basically something that does have a real zoom on it. So even if you have a camera, I know there's one of the iPhones that they're calling it 1x zoom, and there's one that has it makes it do a little bit of fish eye look. But do realize that the 1x zoom, that's as far as you get. It's kind of like stepping forward, you know, one big step if you're going to take a picture. But if you start to try to crop the picture later and you crop it too much, then it could look very blurry. So always try to get closer to your subject, okay? So our cell phones kind of have our fixed cell phone zoom, okay? If you do pinch and zoom, just realize that's still digital zoom. If you took a picture later and cropped it later, you get the same effect than doing the pinch and zoom on the camera. Optical zoom, lens that autofocus is on it, can be wide, and the telephoto starts to stick out and tries to zoom in on your subject. Excuse me. We just talked about digital zoom. We also talked about digital SLR a little bit there too. Okay, now do realize you can come in anytime. That's a big thing about coming to our live classes, because you can feel free to ask questions at any time. Let's go ahead and let's start talking about our memory cards. There we go. All right, so I did finally figure out how to get rid of the taskbar there. Okay, so now we should have a little bit more room. Okay, so we have our memory cards that are going on here. I won't go too far back here. Just realize that used to memory cards, they were, so if you ever have a junk drawer that you open, or have a family that opens a junk drawer, and there's Sony memory cards, and there's the little brick ones that they have. Just thank goodness we've all kind of moved on from the different proprietary formats. We're just kind of sticking with SD cards for right now, okay? So one of the things about the SD card is trying to figure out what kind of SD card that you want for your camera or your device, okay? This is just kind of a quick chart right here. The biggest one is to basically look at your manual. If you look at your manual for your camera or even your Android device, just realize that it'll tell you very easily which ones to get, because you might go to the store and either buy something that's not fast, and then your camera seems to take the really thing that you'll notice is you're trying to do high speed pictures, or if you're having problems with it keeping video, it may be because your memory card is too slow for the device, okay? Or you take a picture and it takes like almost a second or two to actually save it to the camera, and therefore it slows you down from taking pictures. If you're having problems recording video too, it could be your memory card. So realize the biggest thing here is that they've gone to, it'll tell you all this other information too, but mostly this is really how we look at it. We look at our memory card, we'll see where on the memory card it'll say the class or whatever that's on here. It'll have like a number one, okay, so forth. It'll have like, here's a 10 that's on here, so that means it's a class 10. And mostly it's just talking about how fast it can save. A really high speed one, 4K filming. Does everybody need one of these? No, absolutely not. Most cameras, this is kind of what they want right here, is a class 10, or it depends on which ones you're working with. There's no reason to buy a memory card that's faster than what your camera can support, okay? The only thing I can tell you that is maybe it's on sale and you might get a camera in the future, but you don't want to have a slow memory card in there and your camera is optimized for a faster memory card. This also affects the price as well. What's the recommendation in memory card size? I would probably recommend to get as big a memory card in size, meaning memory, that you can afford, okay? Now we also have these small little micro SD cards. To realize these are mostly for it to go, the SD card to go into like an Android phone. But do you realize if you ever did need to use this, or you have an extra one of these, you want to use it in a regular camera, then you can put it in an adapter and it'll work fine, okay? So wherever these guys go, this guy can go too. You just may need an adapter, okay? Again, look at your manual. You know, you don't really need to buy faster than what your camera can support, and you don't want to have slower than what your camera can support. All right, so let's talk about our JPEG format. Mostly this is if you're using, and we talk about this in the other class, the Windows Explorer that's right here, or if you're using some other program. Oh no. Okay, go away. Of course, I clicked down there for a second, and then it decides to come back. Isn't that funny? Okay, so I'll try not to click down there. So basically, if you're using the Windows Explorer and you start to see all these files and you're going, well, I went to the beach, why didn't it save the name of the beach? They don't do that. And tomorrow's class, we'll talk about organizing and importing our pictures and uploading them to the cloud. The Google Cloud is what we're going to focus on. And most of the time, our cameras name it something like photo with a bunch of numbers behind there, or picture with a bunch of numbers. And JPEG is the actual format that most of our cameras use, okay? JPEG, just kind of realize that's what that is. Now, how to reduce red eye, okay? So basically, red eye is caused from a flash hitting the eye, and the light is reflected back into the lens, okay? Red eye is a frequent problem when using built-in digital camera flash because of its proximity to the lens, okay? So some good cameras do have a digital red eye flash mode that you can put them in, and it'll do like a double flash, and that's tried to, you know, make the pupil smaller. So let's say you have a group of folks and you're at a swimming pool, you know, and you're trying to get a picture of everybody, and they're like, okay, they're beside the pool, so you're outside, and then there's the light is behind them, and then you take a picture or something, you get red eye. Well, what should you do? Well, maybe you can move around and get, let's say, the outside floodlights behind you or something. Let's say it's at dusk. I didn't say what time it was. Let's say it's at dusk or nighttime even. So basically what happened is if you move and you get a floodlight behind you, it's less likely that the red eye is going to happen, and it's less likely that they're going to see it. Okay? I mean, less likely the eye will flash, and that'll help with that. There are ways that you can actually fix that. The iPhone has a quick, easy way to do it. We'll talk about that on Thursday when we do our editing. But do realize the best way to get rid of red eye is to deal with it right then when you're trying to take pictures. You may have a family member that kind of does that a lot, okay? So just kind of expect that person to have that issue. Okay, so let's talk about how to use a camera shutter, okay? So the camera shutter, what is it? It's the button that you press that actually takes a picture, okay? Do the cell phones have a shutter? Absolutely. When you click that button, it's not immediate. It'll actually do a little bit of a focus as well. Now, in a second, we'll talk about pressing and holding on our camera screens, or excuse me, our phone screens, and it'll kind of lock in, which is kind of similar to doing this, okay? So we're trying to get our phone cam ready. Move the lens cap if necessary and set the mode dial. Turn on the camera. Now, this seems kind of silly, but my previous camera, one of the things I really liked about it was when I pressed the on button, the lens would come out and it would pop the lens cover off. And if it needed to take a picture, excuse me, needed to take a flash, it would actually automatically lift up the flash on the top of the camera. My newer camera does not do either of those. So I have actually had to get used to turn the camera on, taking the lens cap off, and if I was going to do flash, lifting the flash up so that it could, flash. So completely different brand of camera. So just realize you got to learn your camera, find out what's going to slow you down. Taking the picture, readying the camera, including stabilizing the camera, which we'll talk about that in just a second. Frame the picture. Press the shutter release button halfway to automatically focus. Now, this is a great thing to do. Let's say you've got a couple. You're going to take a picture of two people in front of you with a really, really a big background, like the Grand Canyon or something. But you want to offset them a little bit to the left or right to try to make it kind of fancy picture, which we'll talk about that using our rule of thirds. One of the things you can do is take your and you put them on the left or right. For some reason, the autofocus isn't focusing in on your subject, it's focusing on the background because it's such a vast background. One of the things you can do is take your camera, point it at your couple, press and hold it down a little bit, and that's when it'll autofocus and auto lock. And then you can move your camera to the left or the right, whichever you want to, and then press the button all the way down and it'll take a picture. Now, the other way you do that is you take your finger. If it's on a cell phone camera, press and hold on your subject, and the auto lock should engage. It depends on what camera you're using, but the standard Android and the standard iPhone do both of those similar to just like I mentioned. And then you can move your camera any way you want because you auto locked on the main subject of the couple in front of you. Then you can press the button, and they'll be in focus. Okay. So just a little bit before. Now, most cell phone cameras, you hit the button, it does a little bit of autofocusing. So it could take up to a second till it actually takes the picture. So realize that as well. Anytime you're taking a picture, why not go ahead and take two, especially if it's a group shot? Make sure you take two or more. One of the things, if you're taking a picture of, let's say, a group, and you think they'll be fidgety or something, or they don't really want to be there much, or they're younger and they want to move around, all you got to do is you just say, okay, well, this is a serious one, and you take two pictures and say, okay, next one will be serious, silly, so y'all get ready for that. And it's so funny because when you tell them to be silly, a lot of the times they don't want to be silly. But anyway, take more pictures. You can just delete the ones you don't want. You don't have to print them. So let's talk about our shutter lag, okay? What exactly is shutter lag? Shutter lag is the pause between pressing the shutter button, okay, and it actually takes the picture. Earlier I said that the digital SLR, when we look through here, we click the button. I didn't actually say this earlier in this class, but you actually press the button, it actually is a mechanical reflex and it makes a sound. So these, you actually press the button. There will be a shutter lag, even if it's your cell phone camera, whatever. Get used to how long it takes the camera to actually take the picture, okay? This will prepare you in case, let's say, someone's running around or something. You're like, I want to get like a child's running around you in a circle. Try to get their picture. If you don't learn your camera, learn what your shutter lag is and everything. And then when you press the button, it actually should work out that you actually do get your subject, okay? I will tell you this, some of the cell phone cameras, and I guess this kind of blends into later. Some of the cell phone cameras, I know you can actually hit the volume button when it's in camera mode and it'll take a picture. You may or may want to do that. It depends on how much of a jargon or shakiness that you'll give your camera. So you may or may not want to do that, okay? So shutter lag, try to plan on it. Another thing that I'll do is I'll actually include getting the device out. If it's a camera, trying to get it out of a bag. You should always have some kind of bag for your camera, especially if it rains or something, then you can put it in the bag. Have a little waterproof bag, a nice one. Lowe's is kind of a nice brand that's pretty cheap, but it's nice. And they make waterproof camera bags. Stick your stuff in there, then if it's a light rain, you should be okay. The other thing is, of course, the shutter lag is, I want to take a picture of that. Let me pull my bag over, open the bag, get the camera out, and you should wrap the strap around your hand one time, so that at least one time, I'd say, just in case if you don't put it around your neck so you don't drop it, okay? The worst thing to do, go somewhere, take a bunch of great pictures, something happens, you drop your camera and your photos haven't been backed up yet. All right, so let's talk about some of our symbols. This is one of the reasons why I actually have this as a separate document. So when folks come to class, I'll actually print this out and let them have this. And then when we do the PowerPoint part, just kind of an overview, they don't really get to, to take that with them unless it's requested. But mostly this is the big thing to take with you. So here, let's talk about some of our common camera icons, okay? Some of them are close up, okay? Looks kind of like a flower. This one looks like a kind of circle with a line. This is our timer setting. What's the big deal with the timer setting? Big deal with that is, you'll see I'll talk about taking night photos, setting it up on a tripod. If there's pictures that you want to get in as well, then you could actually set this up. The main thing is 3, 5, and 10. 3, 5, and 10 is usually the standard seconds. And it allows you to get in the camera too. So you could even take a camera, set it up maybe like on a table somewhere, tell it to do this, get everybody lined up, posed, put the camera the right place, hit the button, then you could maybe run over there and be in the picture too. And I don't really use this a lot, but when I do, I'm very excited about it. And then I will remember, oh, look, I was there too. I'm in the picture. So don't leave yourself out of pictures, okay? Even if they're just fun head selfie pictures, okay? With you and families kind of wrapped around you or whatever. Here's one that talks about, the other thing about the timer is, if you're taking night pictures with the, we'll talk about that in a second, night pictures with the shutter open for 4 seconds or so, have it on a tripod. If you don't have an extra clicker, one of the things you could do is just tell it to the timer to do 5 seconds or 10 seconds or so before it takes a picture. So when you actually are physically pressing the button, it won't shake the camera in any way. So we have our play. Usually just play that and it'll show our pictures. And if you can't, your device usually has an up, down, left, right, and lets you go, you know, cycle, pressing left or right, usually cycling through the pictures. Look for the menu on there somewhere. I do know that a lot of these things aren't exactly for every single camera. The big thing is your manual, and you go, oh no, I don't know where that manual is. I haven't used this camera in a while. I guarantee you can find the manual on the camera company's website. Download that. If you're really trying to figure out how to use the device, the easiest thing is to have the manual. Not everything is intuitive, okay? Apple tries to make their products very intuitive, meaning you don't need a manual, but sometimes you still got to look up stuff to be able to figure out where stuff is. So Google's your big resource on that. So here's our continuation mode. If you see something like this, it may say sports mode or something. Just means it takes a whole bunch of pictures. Click, 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 or something. Here's our trash can to delete. Here's also our USB port symbol. It kind of looks like a tree. Here's our important one, turning the camera on and off. It's a circle with a line. The international symbol of power, on or off. Portrait mode's a big one. You may see a lot of the devices. It just means that they're trying to get it so somebody's closer in focus. I do know some of the smartphones have actual portrait mode to try to kind of get a background blurish kind of setting. Here's our landscape mode, the action and the continuous are similar. It tries to kind of set the settings, and we'll talk about those settings in just a minute. Also, some cameras may have a night mode on them. And here's the video mode. Now, I will tell you this, I actually had an issue where I had gotten a new camera, and my old camera, I'd switched the dial to video mode, and I just hit the normal shutter, and that's how I recorded video. And I was actually invited to a surprise party to record the big surprise, and I'd gotten a new camera, used it some, but I knew better, but the old standard of, okay, well, I flipped the dial to the camera mode, which it did have a video mode on the dial, then hit the shutter button. The person came in, everybody said, happy birthday! And I pressed the shutter button thinking it was recording, and it did not. Come to find out, on that camera, the video mode has an extra button on the camera to hit record. A lot of them do to make it quicker, but the only reason you have the dial on there is so you can turn to the video mode and then hit menu. I know that's strange. I still think it's odd. But, you know, having a special button's fine, but maybe have both of those, the mode and then the button. Maybe those should both do record anyway. So a big advice I can give to you is to learn your camera as well. Going on a trip, going to go for a ride, play around with your camera, learn your camera, okay? Let's talk about our auto flash mode. Now this is a big one on here. And my newer camera is actually difficult to turn the flash on and off to the settings that I want. It always seems like every time I use it, I'm going, now how does this work again? It actually has to go into the main menu, and it's about three steps in there to actually turn the flash on or off. It's a lightning bolt that goes down. Usually you'll see audio on there. Again, my camera, the current camera, I actually have to flip up the flash. This will put it in force mode, meaning it's always going to flash. Why would you want that sometimes? You may want that sometimes because your subjects are in the shade, even if it's a bright day outside. If they're in the shade, you may want to do this to brighten their faces up. So this is also no flash. A lot of the places you'll go, stuff plus places like museums, it depends on what it is. They may ask you to not film anything at all. But a lot of the time, the places, they'll actually just say no flash photography, or they may say no videotaping. Now, does that mean that they don't want you to take any kind of pictures anywhere? No. Well, if you went to an art museum, usually as long as you're not using a flash, you can actually take a picture of stuff, but they just have a big sign that says no flash photography. And as long as you go into your settings and turn this off, and if I wasn't using a digital SLR, I would probably turn the sound off of your camera. And if you put your phone in vibrate mode or silent mode, as they call it, for ringing, usually when you take a picture, there's no noise. Because it just makes a noise, it just so that you know a picture was taken. Or just turn that completely off. You'll get more candid pictures of friends or family if your camera doesn't make a noise. All right, we talked about our red eye reduction a little bit. And also, of course, we have our battery life. Battery life, your camera can't do anything if it's dead now, can it? In a minute, we'll talk about some of our other settings on here. Like I said, this is usually what I give folks to take with them. And let's go back to, and I'll actually make this full screen. All right, so we finished kind of learning about our camera, the settings on our camera. Like I said, kind of the best thing to do is to learn your camera, have the manual for your camera, practice with your camera. I've had many classes where I've had folks that, you know, come later and they go, and I go, you know, charge up your camera, go in the backyard, take a bunch of pictures. I said, you'll already just a few pictures, you know, you'll already have learned a lot about your camera. Okay. If it won't cost you anything to print them, just delete what you don't want. Okay. Try to go take some pictures of birds in your yard. All right. So we've kind of moved on from learning about our camera, how we work our camera. Now let's talk about taking pictures with our camera. Okay. So we talked about our zoom level. Now we're going to talk about our issues when we take pictures with our camera. Okay. So let's talk about bad photos. Okay, the blurry blues. The blurry blues. All right, so 50% of all failed photos are due to blur. Okay, you have to be careful. Blur is not always obvious at first. Okay, meaning you could take a picture and you may not realize it's blurry until it's later on the computer screen or you zoom in on it or something. Blur can be caused by an unsteady camera, you being unsteady, low light, put more light on your subject, it's inside a home, try to turn another light on. And I'm not talking about professional photography, I'm just talking about photography right now. The person's moving too fast, if the light is low and they're, you know, moving their arms around, arms are probably going to be blurry. Using a long zoom. Falling out of focus, the person's in focus, out of focus, maybe they're moving around, or using a slow shutter speed, which we'll talk about that in just a second. So basically, this is kind of, the guitar was kind of moving around, wasn't it? Okay. Guitar was moving around, so made the guitar more still, maybe made yourself still taking the picture. Here's an example of slow shutter speed, which we're going to talk about that. So this is like a cityscape, and now it's all blurry. Let's talk about our solution to blur. Solution to blur is a tripod, okay? It really is. So if you're having issues with your pictures being blurry, if it's not working out with your pictures just in general, try a tripod, okay? Even if the autofocus isn't working properly and you're like, oh, this won't do anything, maybe you are moving your camera too much. So what can our solutions be? Well, use a tripod. Use even like a monopod. Now, this is an example. This is one product that not only can you use it like a selfie stick, you can use it as a monopod, meaning you just hold it. It's just a pole, and it keeps your camera steady. All right. This one here makes it shorter. This one here turns the monopod into a complete solution, where it kind of holds the cell phone camera, or of course a normal camera as well. And it even that thing even has a little clicker to it. So Can you get a few solutions in here? Absolutely, you can. Definitely recommend a tripod, you know, for night city photos, or nighttime city photos, I should say. Now, are there some other things that we can do too? Well, you can actually want to zoom in more. There are little clips that you can put on even a cell phone camera, okay, and make it better. I do know that with the new iPhone coming out, there's some companies that are already talking about they're making some devices that not only just hook onto the lens of the camera, but also kind of clicks on, so it's a little bit more secure than just something sitting there. I've even gotten a cheap little fisheye that hooks on the lens from the dollar store, and it was just clipped right on. It's kind of neat, okay? So you can get accessories. You can get little stands that'll hold your camera, hold your cell phone camera in a way that you can easily pull out like this, easily pull it out, clamp it, and take a picture. Set this on a table somewhere. Set it on a timer for, let's say, 5 seconds. Then you're in the picture. You got everybody, all the other family members in the picture too, and you're not having to ask somebody to take a picture of your group or whatever. This also can work out. Let's say you go to eat somewhere and there's a beautiful balcony and it overlooks like a city or something. You go, oh man, I really want to take some great pictures out here. Maybe you can set it up where you can actually have it take pictures of the cityscape like we're about to talk about. And of course, things that are moving. Most of the fancier pictures we'll see, people have used a tripod. Another way to do this is maybe even a funny one. This is kind of like one of those gorilla ones that kind of wrap around stuff. Banister, tree, switch on self timer, user remote control. Remote control. Yes. Yes, you can be in a photo too. Okay. This is definitely a photo. This is, as you see, the background is well lit up. Here's our people here as well. This may or may not have a flash. It just depends on how close they were. But this is definitely on like a tripod to be able to get the picture just right with the light and it not be blur. Okay. Or blurry, I should say. All right. So no, don't just hold your camera up like this. Don't just do two hands with your camera like that. Even during the daylight, you can still make your photos blurry. And your camera, when you click that button, you may go, oh, it's over. But maybe your cell phone was still trying to zoom in and you moved the camera too early. Okay. So what can you do? You can become your own tripod. Okay. Try to lean against something to make it more firm where you're standing. Okay. Spread your legs apart a little bit to make your have a little bit more steadiness. It's where you are. Don't just stand on one foot or something. Hold your camera with the arms pressed against your body, kind of like this, becoming your own tripod. Take a breath, or you breathe out, whichever one. I've had someone go, which one? It's like, whichever. Or lean against something. I've taken some pictures of at a restaurant. It came out really good because I set it on the banister and I told it 10 seconds and it was like, wow, this is great. I didn't have anything that was a tripod with me. Okay. So get creative. You may look a little silly now, but it doesn't matter behind the camera what you look like. It's what you look like in front of the camera. I'm sure some famous person said that. All right, let's talk about our different sources of light. Now, many of our cameras, we may actually be able to go into the settings and tell it, or if it has scene mode or something, we may actually be able to tell it what kind of lighting is around us, okay? If it's sunlight, now the auto on a lot of these cameras, when we hold down that shutter button, it's supposed to kind of guess what the lighting is, but it may not be very perfect, or it may not be 100% sure about what the white balance is, okay? So let's talk about using the flash during the day. If the sun is creating harsh shadows on your subject, switch to the flash. If they're too bright, step back a little bit, okay? And then try it again. Just because it's bright outside, if they're in shadow, you may not be able to see their face, okay? Let's talk about one of the things you can do is you can talk about, the harsh light, a fluorescent light inside like an office or something. You may want to go into the settings and tell your camera that we are using a fluorescent light. So one of the things that'll let you do is it'll actually compensate for the lighting situation that's set up, okay? What is the golden hour? The golden hour is outside shooting portraits, landscapes. Golden hour is light is soft and color moves more vibrant an hour after sunrise and an hour before sunrise, okay? A lot of the times that can be at 10 o'clock in the morning, 9:30, 10 o'clock, afternoon, about 4 o'clock or so. You know, daylight times. People ask me that question all the time. I go, I don't know. Just you'll go outside and you're not squinting a lot. That really kind of means that you're kind of in the golden hour or the golden light. Okay. What can you do if you're still traveling, you're trying, and people are squinting? It's not really much you can do. Maybe you can find a little bit more shade. Maybe you can turn a different way so they're not staring directly into the sunlight. So they're not having to squint when they take a picture. Because hey, okay, everybody open your eyes. That still doesn't, take a great picture. All you can do is you'd say, well, we took a picture while we were there. Okay? Because everybody still wants to squint their eyes because this light's too bright. Let's talk about exposure, okay? Exposure is the amount of light allowed to the image sensor, okay? Now, what we don't want is here we have our overexposure, too bright inside our church, and it does the stained glass. So someone says, hey, I'm trying want to get a picture in here, and you're like, oh, it'll show the stained glass, it'll show the inside and the outside light coming in. Usually you get overexposure or you get underexposure, okay? So let's talk about that. The overexposure is too much light, overbright image with the white spots. Here's your correct exposure, kind of in the middle. Then we have our underexposure where everything's too dark, okay? Too little light, underbright image with black spots, okay? How to get the best exposure can be is in the scene with contrasting light, okay? Can be difficult. You may have to go to the settings and turn that up and down, which we're gonna talk about here in a second. They may be able to try to push the auto, maybe even try to get it more in kind of a shadow or more in the sunlight. We'll also talk about HDR. Now, you could take a photo using HDR mode on your camera. Well, let's talk about our smartphone fixed exposures. Now, earlier I talked about our nice cameras, digital SLRs. They may be able to take better quality pictures if it knows exactly what it's doing. But a lot of our smartphones, they know more about what type of lighting that's going on than maybe even our high-end cameras. The reason that is, and I kind of feel like what we really need is Apple to put a big lens on a smartphone and or an iPhone, and then we can actually get the both of all every world, okay? But they haven't done that yet. There's some Android cell phones coming out of South Korea and China and stuff that there's one that does have a big lens on it, but I've heard it's not very good. But anyway, so just kind of the idea of what software comes with your device and how can it compensate or what can you download. Well, the big thing is this. So you're basically taking a picture of a group of folks here, and they're overexposed, underexposed. You can tell very quickly in the camera, the picture doesn't look very good. What you do is you need to tap on your subject, and then basically you should get a square and a scroll, like a bar that you can scroll up and down to change the exposure level with your finger, okay? Tap and hold if you want it to auto lock on something. Tap and hold, and then you can actually do like a swipe, that's the word I'm looking for. A little bit of a swipe up or a down to increase or decrease the exposure. Also, you can control the autofocus if you want to. This is also how you lock in the autofocus. And if you're done, just hit the reset button and it gets you out of there. Now, so the thing in the foreground is well lit or bright, and also the thing in the background is kind of well lit or bright as well. So what does HDR do? Well, if you try to do this with just a normal camera, you basically take three pictures at different settings, and then you have to have software where you merge them together, and it's similar to what we'll be talking about on Thursday, okay? Merging the different layers. But in the HDR with something like an iPhone, we put it in HDR mode, it actually takes at least three pictures, and it'll try to merge them together. And you kind of get a surreal, when it works well, you get a great picture, but it still looks a little bit surreal. So that's an HDR photo. So could the HDR take a picture inside the church and then kind of do the exposures together? Absolutely it could, okay? Kind of merge those things together to make it look a little bit better, okay? So that's HDR mode on the devices. Now, no high-end camera actually has that software built in like that, but maybe they do on some of the newer ones. All right, now we're going to talk about a fun part that's fun. It's complex, but also realize that it's something that you're going to have to cover and kind of learn a little bit more and kind of play around with, okay? So I'll give you the tools here. And I'll give you the explanation, but then you may have to still kind of think about it for yourself because it still is kind of a complex subject. So we're going to talk about aperture. So exposure can be controlled mainly through two camera settings, okay? The aperture and the shutter speed. The aperture is the size of the opening in the lens that always allows light through the lens, similar to an eye's pupil, okay? Now, this is one of those where someone says, I want to know how to take a picture of a subject and they're in focus, but the background is out of focus, kind of like I see, and it's basically changing our focal point, okay? Our depth of field. I won't go into it too much. It's basically changing your depth of field, what is in focus. So with this is a very wide depth of field. Everything's in focus. So the lower the number, the less depth of stuff is in focus, okay? If you go too low, it gets odd, which I'll show you in a second. But let's say you do here. So even if you locked here, you could, you know, it's a very wide and long focus, so things are all in focus. This has a very shallow focus, so the background will be out of focus. So let's look at our aperture chart here. Aperture measured in f-stops, it determines the size of the opening in your lens, okay? So we start off with a small number. It has less in focus. The larger opening, shallow depth of field, okay? We make it higher. So first we start off here. This is mostly what folks say that they want. It's a low f-stop number. So this is, and something closer to them is not in focus either. It's just this one little area. We push it higher, there's still focus. Now the other things are starting to get in focus, and then boom, a higher number now makes something closer, something a little further away in focus, keeps going higher number to the point that everything is in focus. If it's close, far away, or very far away. This is actually one of the issues with, I guess, watching sports at home, is that depending on what the depth of field is, it may look like, let's say the football player should have caught that ball that was like right in front of them when it was really 3 feet away, okay? Was it even close? And we just couldn't really tell that because of the shallow depth of field. That's one of the big reasons why they do have many, many different angles when they do things like an instant replay or something. So, change our shallow depth of field. Want everything in focus, no blur, higher number, okay? Lower number, certain things will not be in focus. And if you do it right, hopefully you're just your subject, the background, if there is anything closer to you, will be out of focus as well. Now, I will tell you this, with the cell phones, this can kind of be, if a cell phone can do it properly, you just kind of tap on the screen. Remember I talked about the autofocus lock earlier? Tap on your subject, press and, tap and hold for a second. It'll lock the exposure, or it'll actually, excuse me, it'll lock the focus on that subject, and it might make, because it's close, it might make the background automatically out of focus. So even with a cell phone, you can possibly get this to work fairly quickly. In class, I usually demonstrate by taking my cell phone out and trying to do a photo with, let's say, a water bottle or something like that, then everything is in focus and the background's out of focus. Usually it's pretty easy to do. You just tap and hold on the screen, and there you go. All right, let's talk about our next setting. Let's talk about shutter speed. Now, shutter speed appears as whole numbers, okay, but are really fractions. So if you're dealing with decimals, you're dealing with aperture or f-stop. If you're dealing with fractions or whole numbers, then you're dealing with shutter speed, okay? Mostly if you see a fraction on there. So what exactly does that do? Well, this actually controls the exposure as well. Now, I have one good, and I'll talk about this in just a second, you'll see. There actually is a setting on most of our cameras that allow us to play around with just one of these settings to whatever you want it to be, and the camera will automatically do the rest, okay? So after this, I'll tell you what those settings are, and then play around with it and have fun. Go in the backyard, take some pictures. I know we're all kind of still staying home and safe and everything. Maybe taking walks. Well, take your camera with you, take pictures of just random things. And then, like I said, if it doesn't work out, just delete the photo, but you'll have better photography skills when it's all over. One cool thing that I've had where we do the class on ground, and if it's like a few days apart or whatever, a week, I've had it where it's a week apart, and then we actually encourage folks to take pictures and bring them to class and not show them on the screen, just be like, well, this is my camera, these are the pictures I took. And I've even had one fella that came back and he goes, well, I took a trip this last weekend, I got pictures of bald eagles. And it was like, wow, that's great. So he took some of the skills that we covered in this class, and when he came to the next class, he had used those skills. So long shutter speed, spend more time letting light in, which can also help the dark environment and create an artistic blur effect with movement. Okay, so mostly we're going to be talking about the trying to freeze things in time, but you could use this to change the exposure level as well. Okay, so let's talk about freezing things in time. Okay. So short shutter speed spends less time letting light in, which allows for quicker pictures and the ability to freeze time in great detail. Okay, so instead of this picture, which most of us we would get like with a camera or even a cell phone, but this is what we want. We want it to look like it's frozen. That means that you have to basically get your camera to take a picture quicker. Okay, here we are, someone's walking, slow shutter speed, faster shutter speed, get a picture of their feet walking. Slow shutter speed is the length of time the camera's lens shutter is open. In other words, how long the camera spends taking the picture. Okay. Now, here's one shutter speed. Now, remember the fractions are seconds. So this is 1/1000th of a second. It looks like the water is frozen in midair, doesn't it? Okay. Here's one that's 1/125th of a second. And it's still pretty frozen in the air. It's starting to look a little more blurry. Here's 1/25th. Blurrier. And this is a lot blurrier. So this is here kind of what our cameras normally do, in between 25 and 15 or so, because they just would try to get everything in focus. They're not really trying to get the shutter speed. So you have to kind of play around with the settings on that. Now, some of these things you may actually be able to accomplish by downloading a newer app, like a Camera Plus app on an iPhone, and then messing around with the settings there, because they'll actually talk about some of these same topics we're talking about. So this is 1 second. It looks like the sugar falling onto the strawberries, I believe. It's really fast. Here's making it 1/60th of a second slower, and 1/1000th of a second makes you look like the little grains of sugar are kind of frozen in air, doesn't it? We see food commercials, and this is kind of some of the stuff they do. They'll film the food in slow motion, or, in kind of frozen in time and stuff. Even if it's a video. Now, this is a neat one here. Do I believe that you could do this? Absolutely. I've done some ones like this with a cell phone. So kind of imagine it's absolutely pitch black right now. You go into the camera settings. You change the shutter speed to be on for 4 seconds, not less than a second. And then you tell the child, give the child a sparkler. Thank you. Give the child a sparkler, light it up, tell them to write their name or do a circle. And now, and then they go out there, try to hold your phone as steady as possible. And there you go right there. You'll get kind of the streaming lights like that. Now, how do I get the ones that make the cars look like they're streaming? Because people really like that. So the big thing about that is basically a tripod, all right? Some cameras may not actually have the ability to do 30 seconds. I think mine will do something like 15 or so. It's longer than, some other cameras that I had too, so that's better. But you set up a camera, and like I said, I'm gonna tell you about the automatic settings in just a second. Set up your camera, tell the shutter speed, to keep it, for as long as it possibly can. This camera can do 30 seconds or so, and then boom, there you go right there. It looks like the cars are lights going down the street. Okay, so let me show you. So let's talk about our four main camera modes. Now, this is that dial that's on your camera. And like I said, if you downloaded some apps like the night capture app, or even the Camera Plus app, basically you'll see these programs, you'll see settings like this as well. P basically just means that it's a program mode. Most of the time I just kind of skip over that one because I mostly want it to be something that I'm setting by hand. Now, the good part about this is the main two modes that we talked about, which are the shutter speed, of course, and the aperture. And this is where it gets a little more confusing again, because our camera may call it something else on the dial. So your camera may say A or AV. That means aperture. The really cool part about this is, and let me read it verbatim here. In this mode, you set the aperture and the camera automatically calculates the appropriate shutter speed for a given exposure value. Meaning, you want to play around with the taking pictures, put it in this mode, and then the shutter speed is automatically calculated. Now, also we go down here. When you want to control how much of the background and foreground are in focus, this is especially useful for portraits and macro photography when you want the subject in focus and the background blurred. wide apertures or landscape and architecture shots when you want everything sharp and a narrow aperture. Or you can put it in the shutter mode. My camera actually says TV for some reason. Why? I'm not 100% sure. But I flip it to the TV mode, and in this mode, you set the shutter speed and the camera automatically calculates the appropriate aperture for a given exposure level. So this is kind of fun because it's like an automatic, hey, I want to play around with the shutter speed, see if I can get some of those shots that I just showed you, maybe try to get some water, you know, frozen in the air or something. Put it in this mode, play around with it. The camera tries to kind of guess everything else on there, so you're not trying to calculate, you know, what the exposure is, and you're not trying to calculate what the aperture level is. Now, if you want to do all that by hand, I don't really talk about ISO because these two settings usually take care of the ISO settings if you have it in that. The other thing, of course, is you can try to effectively get these happen in automatic mode, but sometimes it's just trying to keep, it's kind of set to put all the, try to get everything in focus, okay? What is M? M is manual mode, okay? So that means that you have to do everything, okay? You'll have to figure out what the shutter speed is. The problem with this is you may get, mess around with the exposure level. You take a picture and go, why is everything too bright? Why is everything too dark? It's because of the exposure level. So a good thing to do is not use manual mode, actually use the aperture mode or the shutter speed modes depending on what your project is. Okay. Now I've also got some definitions of different terms here on the next page here, shutter, shutter speed, HDR, and some photo tips. We're about to continue with our thing here. I also have some homework for you. I'd love to tell everybody to do this, and then the folks come to tomorrow's class, they've done some of these things, messing around with the aperture, three pictures. There you go, exposure, you know, some good homework, some good ways to practice. I guess I'll add a space there. All right, so let's go back here. Let's talk about actually taking pictures and talking about our composition, okay? So we've talked about using our camera. We've talked about our battery, our memory card, what a megapixel is. We've covered a lot of topics so far. Let's kind of finish up on taking a better picture. Composition is the selection and arrangement of objects in the picture area. A well-composed photograph is more attractive and pleasing to the viewer. There are six guidelines to follow to get well-composed photographs. Now, here's one that comes up. I've actually had it where I've had this class, someone came to the next class and go, you have just ruined me from watching movies. I said, why is that? And he said, it's because now when I watch movies, I can actually see the rule of thirds in the movie screen. I go, I'm sorry, but that's what they've been doing. She said, so I've seen a few movies and now all I see is, oh, is the aperture ratio. There's the rule of thirds right there. And I go, I'm sorry, that's just the way it's going to happen. So let's talk about thirds and the golden crop are the foundation for movie and cinema. This was my portion of adding this, was just so that you kind of get a bit quicker feel of what these things are and where you've seen them and why it's important. Before we ever even really delve into how to do it, okay? So we have, here's from a movie, and if you look, we have them in certain areas, even our faces. So believe it or not, that's actually something called the rule of thirds, which we're about to talk about there. So if we actually drew some lines, we could see where our subject, the light, and even the desk there kind of line up. What about here? That's pretty lined up from a James Bond movie. Okay, pretty neat. What about here? We see those lines. We do, we kind of see our lines here, don't we? Their eyesight and then our desk. What about this one here? What does this do? This is actually something called leading lines, which we'll talk more about that later. Get your eyes to follow the subject. So we're going to talk about composition, simplicity, fill the frame, rule of thirds, lines, balance, framing, and also mergers, good and bad. So simplicity, focus on one subject. Have a simple background. Place the subject slightly off center. So here's our pictures here. Would this picture look better if I was closer? Think to yourself. Try to focus on your subject. And think about the details as well. Start far and move closer. Fill the frame with objects that fit. So this tells a complete story, doesn't it? This tells a story of, I guess, this family visiting Washington, D.C. Okay. Long-range shots provide depth and perspective. Let's talk about simplicity, fill the frame. So we have the picture here of the bird far away. If we get closer, we see a lot more detail with the bird. We see a picture of the girl kind of far away. We don't really care about this brick wall. We want to see her face is what we want. And this is kind of our subject, but from a parking lot. Are we trying to focus on the cars in the parking lot? No, we want to focus on the church or the mission. So we zoom in, get closer, crop our picture. What about Mr. Whale here? Mr. Walrus, excuse me. Create the single photo on the right. Now, is this more perfect? Or does this look like just a group? Or if you just want to focus on one? Single, dominant, or angle on a subject? What about from this angle? Here's a child, looks like it's on a playground drawing. We want to focus on what the child's doing. If I took a picture from, you know, the child's viewpoint, I could see the child's face, but if I did that, then it could be too crowded with what's going on around them. This just allows us to focus on this. This is a picture I took with my cell phone. I just got really close to the little flower. I did that thing where I pressed and held on my subject, and because I was close enough to it, it actually did the autofocus and set the shutter speed. So of course, so the background was, set the aperture so the background was blurry. Simplicity is often key to good composition. Now this is a picture I took, went to the, it was near the beach and the low country, and they had some a restaurant and just waiting to eat. Decided to go out on the back porch and walk around and get to see the shrimp boats and stuff. And when I actually look here, they had a little sign made of the crab that said, "Please do not feed the birds." Okay. Well, that looks kind of like an interesting picture. Would you say that picture is interesting? It's an interesting picture, but guess what? If I just turn to the right a little bit, boom, I got a whole better thinking about the rule of thirds as well. May not, you've taken these pictures, but you may not have realized it, or if you go, that looks really good, or if you didn't. So with the rule of thirds, I kind of have my subject here on the bottom left, the top left, and I have leading lines going on, which we're about to talk about as well. Just by turning my head a little bit, doing it at an angle, boom, I got everything in the picture. It looks inviting, and it looks very interesting as well, okay? Yes, I took that picture. So let's talk about what is the rule of thirds, okay? Now, it is recommended to turn on the grid on your smartphone. I won't go into how to do that because some of the phones are very different, but you can go into the settings, camera, put on grid lines, and that your rule of thirds will pop up and keep it on the screen all the time. If you have that on the screen all the time, I guarantee you, you'll take better pictures and not even realize it, okay? Rule of thirds, it's like a tic-tac-toe board. Place the subject at one of the intersections. Place horizontal lines low in the picture. Rarely should horizontals be in the middle. Excuse me, horizons be in the middle of your pictures. So try to line it up. Like here's a photo, here's kind of our sunset, our horizon going off in this distance. All we really do is line it up with the tree here. The rest of everything else is kind of arbitrary. It'll start, we can talk about negative space and a bunch of stuff. Mostly try to have your subject in one of these areas and try to have it so that there's a little bit of a horizon going on. Table, you know, just like in the movie pictures we looked at. Rule of thirds continues. You may find one in life. It's one in life. Rule of thirds. Boom, rule of thirds right there. We have our horizon lined up here. Are going out of the horizon, even though it's not perfect. That is it. That's kind of the horizon line. This picture I really liked. And do you see the rule of thirds? I do too. Is it exactly on the line? No, but it's our subject is here. So we have our subject comparing here to here. Rule of thirds is so simple that many photographers want to look for something more complicated. But mostly just trying to use it to align your subject, okay? So here's our subject here. We have this area lined up as the horizon. What about this area? This area is taking care of itself. What about here? Do you see the line lined up? There's the line. What about this little girl here looking in? So I could zoom in, it's on her face, but now I'm more kind of interested in what she's looking at. So this is kind of a line her up here. Her eyesight is our horizon, isn't it? Okay, Mac, I'm glad you like that. So here we go this way. We have our little girl, and I think that's a pet. Anyway, here's our horizon lined up, little girl. This is kind of arbitrary. That's really the two. So if you get two, you don't have to do four out of four. If you can do two here, it's great. Here's, looks like someone's on a cruise, took a bottle, set it up here. Very easy to do, very easy to set that up. Here's our magnificent dog, look overlooking his domain like a lion. There's a line, and that kind of sets up the horizon here, but mostly it's the dog. All right, rule of thirds, sense of movement. Give moving subjects room to move in the picture, okay? So, which do you find more interesting, this picture or kind of this picture, okay? Here's our bird right in the middle. It's kind of boring. This, putting the bird here, gives them motion coming into the screen. This is a person, we kind of see a little more of their face. This is their leaving. This is an action. This feels like I'm imagining where they've been. This is where they're going, okay? Now let's talk about the golden ratio. Golden ratio isn't something that you'll really do, I guess you say, on purpose, and then we'll talk about small things and far away things. I guess you'd say closer or farther away. Golden ratio can seem very complex at first. It's quite simple. Slightly more complex version of the rule of thirds. Instead of a regular grid, the frame is divided into a series of squares. Okay. I have a whole website to talk about that. Basically, the stairs. And then we have our couple here talking. So it kind of fits right in the frame. It kind of surrounds them. But if you look here, you see this? That's kind of our rule of thirds. So even if we hold up rule of thirds here, here's our subjects going across with their heads. And then if I go this way, it's kind of intersects both of them, doesn't it? So if we look here, it kind of swoons this way. Again, here's our rule of thirds. Do you see it happening? There it is. There's our horizon lining it up. And then there's our intersection. All right, so which photo is more interesting? This one? This one? Or this one? Which one kind of leads you someplace else? Think it's the one in the middle because it leads you to look this way. And this feels kind of cut off and disconnected. Talk about lines. So the lines have to be perfect? No, they don't have to be perfect. They're just kind of leading lines that take you somewhere with your eye. Can they be S? Absolutely. Here's our leading lines, taking us someplace else. We have our fence here. Fences are great to do leading lines. It's our fence, and I even like how it kind of wobbles a little bit. You see lines here? Absolutely, they're lines that go just like this. Do you see it? Now, if we just had this, if we didn't have this area, because this looks like all these things are going somewhere, don't they? These lines. But if you cropped it this way, it would be like you wouldn't feel the same way. Here's one that's great for photography, especially like a bride or a subject. Just moved in the right place so that these pillars all of a sudden created leading lines. What about the train track? Train tracks are excellent leading lines. Coming out, going around. Wonder where they're going. Leading lines. And here we are. We're looking this way, and then we see there's someone up there at the road. Oh, they're going fishing. So this whole picture tells a full story, doesn't it? Now, balance. To prevent having a picture that looks lopsided, provide objects and shapes on either side of the picture. Provides visual support to the object that need it. The wheel on the right is not in the picture, and the wheel lacks support. The wheel has visual support on the both sides of the picture. So if we look here, this looks like a more balanced picture. Now she's more lined up even because it would be here. See? Now let's talk about balance, or continue talking about balance. Include a stationary object or lesser importance of size on the other side of the frame. This balances out the composition without taking too much focus off the main subject of the photograph. So it's just something that's here and something that's farther away. Now, if we look at our just basic rule of thirds, is that set up as basic rule of thirds? Absolutely. The church tower in the distance provides balance on the other side of the frame. Eiffel Tower in the distance counters balance. Let's talk about framing. Use foreground objects to highlight the subject and give the picture depth. So we have this picture, or we have this picture. We have the other things. There's our framing set up. Pictures of scenery should have a foreground and a background, provide some visual depth to the picture. So if something's really, really large, don't just take a picture of it. Take a picture of it contrasting to something else. Here's our framing. So here our trees are kind of doing our natural framing. Here someone's taking a picture through an old door. Here's kind of the way the rope. The floating net, I guess you'd say, lines up here. It makes a leading line. It focuses. And even this picture here, the guy's asleep, looks like in class, and the girl's using her purse as a framing part. And you see that this is out of focus, so it makes us make sure we're focused on him. The purse is a little out of focus as well. So a picture doesn't have to be, the most beautiful picture ever. It can be just a fun picture. Let's talk about mergers. Bad. Mergers bad. So this looks like the bird's kind of getting everything coming out of the bird. There's the bird right there by itself. Much better. What about this one? Looks like stuff's coming out of his head. Just maybe make him step to the left or the right, and then boom, you got a better picture. Mergers are something to avoid, a background object that interferes with the subject, an object that is too close to the subject that takes attention away from the subject. A border merger is when people's heads or feet are cut off the edge of the picture. What about this? She looks like balloon girl, balloon head girl. Again, maybe step to the right, put a bush or something like that behind her, take her picture, she doesn't have these balloons coming out of her head. Boom, looks much better. All right, now we're gonna finish up. I got a little quick video to show, and then we'll basically be wrapping our class up. So remember these guidelines. Remember these are guidelines. They're not rules, okay? So I'm going to show a final video and then we'll finish up class. So this is from a photographer. This is a video found on YouTube and it's called 9 Photo Composition Tips from Steve McCurry. And I will mute myself. Enjoy.
Remember that composition is important, but also rules are meant to be broken. So the main point is to enjoy yourself while you're photographing and photograph in your own way, in your own style.
Excellent. So I hope you enjoyed our class. Did you learn something new? You turn my light on, talking about lighting. Yay, there we are. Did you learn something new? I hope you did. So don't forget, try simplicity, rule of thirds, lines, framing, you know, and thank you for joining me today. So, do we have any final questions? Hang on. There we go. All right, so just a reminder of our classes that we have going on for the rest of the month here. Don't forget about our class tomorrow. We're going to be doing Gadget Help with me, Alex. It's kind of a drop-in. You come by. And we also may be learning about the new, we're switching from a different service, RB Digital, to a new service named Libby. So we'll learn more about that with our audiobooks and everything. And that's very, very exciting to see what possibilities and new things that we have going on with that. And also we're going to be doing our photography fundamentals and cloud backup at 2:30. So then come join me on Thursday for Chess 101 chess class. And then we're going to be doing we're going to be doing advanced photo editing and layers, which is a new class. The layers part, we'll be using the GIMP software, which is like Photoshop, and then with our other classes that we have coming up at the end of the month. Little side note, the libraries are open with limited services and hours. Things, of course, we're not doing any in-house classes. That's why we're doing our stuff virtually, and also no study rooms and things available. Curbside holds pickup is available. You can check that out on the website gchrl.org for more details. Of course, you can go to the library, call into the library questions Monday through Friday, 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. Please don't forget to like us on Facebook and subscribe to our YouTube channel. Remember, we're trying to get 100 YouTube subscribers so that we can get our own YouTube address. Right now, if you're looking for our YouTube channel, which you're on our channel right now, just go to YouTube and search GCHRL videos and it will pop right up. Pop right up. Pop! It'll pop right up. Well, thank you for joining me today. And I will see you guys tomorrow and also Thursday as well as we're finishing up September and our photography series. Thank you for joining me. I will see you again soon. Stay safe. Have fun taking photos and everything. And I recommend if you come to our bird class, take lots of pictures of birds outside and stuff. And I will see you guys again next time. Okay? Have a great day. Bye-bye.